Organization is a specialized agency of the United Nations responsible for international public health. According to WHO, pneumonia accounts for 15% of all deaths of children under 5 years of old and killing 8,8,694 children in 2017. Pneumonia is a form of acute respiratory infection that affects the lungs. When an individual has pneumonia, the alveoli are filled with pus and fluid, which makes breathing painful and limits oxygen intake. Pneumonia is the single largest infectious cause of death in children worldwide. Pneumonia killed children of age under 5 years and accounts for 15% of death of children. Pneumonia affects children and families everywhere but is most prevalent in South Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa. Children can be protected from pneumonia if it is prevented with simple interventions and treated with low-cost, low-tech medication and care. So, in the coming session, we will be discussing about the causes, signs, symptoms and the pathophysiology. And coming to the transmission, pneumonia can be spread in a number of ways. The virus and the bacteria that are commonly found in a child's nose or throat can infect the lungs if they are inhaled. They may also spread via airborne droplets from a sneeze or a cough. And in addition, pneumonia may spread through blood, especially during and shortly after birth. More research needs to be done on different pathogens causing pneumonia and the ways that are transmitted. And this is of a critical importance for treatment prevention. So, pneumonia is an acute respiratory illness associated with recently developed radiological pulmonary shadowing, which may be a segmental lobar or multilobar. So, it causes an inflammation in the lungs characterized by accumulation and secretion of inflammatory cells in the alveoli. So, now here you can see the normal alveoli and the alveoli infected with pneumonia lesions. So, here in the alveoli infected with pneumonia, fluid and pus cells are filled within the airspace of your alveoli, and the normal alveoli here airspace is totally empty, which means that the inflammation caused in the alveoli, which is filled with the fluid, making it difficult for your body to get to the oxygen which it needs. Now coming to the epidemiology, it occurs throughout the year, results from different etiological agents varying from the seasons and according to the ages. And coming to the clinical manifestations, it is severe in very young elderly and is chronically ill to the patients. Now coming to the etiology, it is caused, the causative agent of pneumonia is due to bacterial infection, viruses, fungi or parasites. And Streptococcus pneumoniae actually is a causative agent of pneumonia, and Mycoplasma pneumonia is more in young people and rarely in elders. And Staphylococcus aureus is more common following an episode of influenza, that is the viral infection, and other infectious agents such as fungi also causes this pneumonositis carinii. Now coming to the classification is totally based on two types, that is type 1 pneumonia and type 2 pneumonia. So type 1 pneumonia is lobar pneumonia and bronchopneumonia, and type 2 is community based, that is community acquired pneumonia CAP and hospital acquired pneumonia HAP. So lobar pneumonia is an acute bacterial infection which affects one or more lobes is involved. in the lungs. And coming to the bronchi, here more patchy alveolar consolidation associated with bronchiolar and bronchiolar infection is often affected with both lobes of your lungs. So now coming to the CAP, that is community acquired pneumonia. Here the onset is commonly due to the community during the first day of the hospitalization is mainly causes this community acquired pneumonia within less than 24 hours of hospitalization. And in hospital acquired pneumonia is the pneumonia that was not incubating upon admission developing in the patient hospitalized for more than 2 days. It affects all ages with all groups, but particularly according to the age. Worldwide CAP and HAP continues to kill more children than in any other illness. Now coming to the pathophysiology, it includes 4 stages, that is congestion, red hepatization, gray hepatization, and resolution. And in congestion of the pneumonial organism reaches the alveoli, there is an outpouring of fluids into the alveoli that we have discussed in the previous slide, and the organism develops into a serous fluid and infection spreads. And coming to the red hepatization, that is the second phase of pathophysiology. Here the lung appears red and granular, similar to that of liver, which is why the process is called hepatization. Next, in the gray hepatization, blood flow decreases and leukocytes and the fibrin consolidate is in the affected part of the lung. Next, coming to the resolution, complete resolution healing occurs if there is no complications and exudates become lysed and is processed by macrophages. So the normal lung tissue is restored and person's gas exchange ability returns to the normal. In actual pathophysiology of pneumonia, here bacterial and virus living in nose, sinus or mouth may spread to your lungs, which will enter directly into your lungs through droplet infection. So each lung has separate section called lobes. Normally, as you breathe, air moves freely through your trachea or through your windpipe, then through the larger tubes called bronchioles and through smaller tubes called bronchioles, and finally into the 2 sacs called alveoli. So your airways and alveoli are flexible and springy. When you breathe in, each air sac inflates like a small balloon, and when you exhale, this sacs deflate. So small blood vessels called capillaries surround your alveoli, and the oxygen from the air you breathe passes into your capillaries. Then the carbon dioxide from your body passes out of your capillaries into your alveoli, so that your lungs get rid of it when you exhale. If you have pneumonia, your airway or the lungs that have an infection caused by these germs, that are the bacteria, viruses, fungi or the parasites, so then your airways catches these germs and the mucus that lines upon your trachea, bronchi and bronchioles. And some hair-like cilia lining is also present, which constantly pushes these mucus and the germs out of your airways, spill out through coughing. Sometimes these germs make it a pass through your mucus and cilia and enter your alveoli. So normally cells of your immune system attack these germs, which keep them making you sick. And moreover, if your immune system is weak due to age, illness or fatigue, pneumonia causing germs can overwhelm your immune system and it begins to multiply, and your bronchi and the alveoli become inflamed due to the immune cells and start fighting against germs. Hence the inflammation causes alveoli fill with the fluid, making it difficult for your body to get the oxygen it needs. So this is the overall pathophysiology of pneumonia, how it invades, how it infects the lungs. Now coming to the signs and symptoms, high fever, chills and shortness of breath, nausea, cough, a red color, cough is observed, a rust color cough is observed, sputum is observed, and chest pain when you breathe deeply, and our dusky or purplish skin color is also observed. And moreover, the cyanosis, which means that dusky or purplish skin is observed, which is due to oxygen saturation as air may be low and the patient cyanosed due to distress. Okay, and lung abscess is also formed, which is called emphysema, and increased breathing rate and as well as high blood pressure is also one of the symptoms for pneumonia. Now coming to the complications, there are several complications, that is emphysema, that is the lung abscesses is formed, and difficulty in breathing, septic arthritis, endocarditis, and upper abdominal tenderness, and respiratory and pulse rate may also be raised, and blood pressure may also increase. Next, coming to the investigations, full blood count, complete blood count, clinical analysis should be taken, and as well as erythrocyte sedimentation rate, ESR rate, which it indicates the level of infection and the level of foreignness, that is the antigenicity that has invaded in the host organism, and a blood culture, and further investigations which includes urea and electrolytes, and liver function test, and serology and cold agglutinin test is also performed for mycoplasma, and arterial blood gases are also calculated in order to just know the severity of the disease. And sputum samples are also taken for gram staining. Through gram staining, we can easily characterize the type of bacteria that has been infected, that is in order to confirm the bacterial species, whether it is streptococcus, whether it has been infected due to streptococcus pneumonia, or it is a viral infection. And as well as oropharynx swab is also taken. PCR for mycoplasma pneumonia and other atypical pathogens are also performed. PCR is nothing but polymerase chain reaction. Next, a chest x-ray report is also taken, which may vary depending upon the phase of inflammatory response. So lobar pneumonia has a patchy observation is observed on the lobes, and on the bronchopneumonia, typically patchy and segmental shadowing is observed. Now coming, so this is the lobar pneumonia x-ray report. So we have already discussed that a patchy segmentation is observed, patchy area is observed, smoky area is observed on one of the lobe, and patchy consolidation is observed on both of the lobes of your lungs. So that is bronchopneumonia. Now coming to the pharmacology of that is generally used to treat bacterial pneumonia is penicillin, amoxicillin, and ceftriaxone, azithromycin, erythromycin, rifamycin. So generally for any bacterial infections, penicillin, azithromycin, erythromycin is commonly used in any bacterial infection. Now coming to the treatment, most people can be treated at home, and a patient with other serious illness such as heart attack, heart disease, chronic pulmonary disease, and kidney diseases are given more powerful high dose antibiotics are generally referred. And for viral pneumonia, antivirals are given, and for fungal pneumonia, antifungal drugs are given for treatment. And coming to the vaccination here, there are two kinds of vaccines, that is PPV, which is nothing but pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine, which is given to all adults, and PCV is a pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, which it is highly immunogenic in infants and young children. And coming to the management of pneumonia, We should generally not smoke and should not take any drink, and indoor air pollution is also one of the reason for pneumococcal infections. And just stay rest and fit, wear a surgical mask if you meet the deceased patient. Preventing pneumonia in children is an essential component of a strategy to reduce child mortality. Immunization against pneumococcus, measles and whooping cough, that is pertussis, is the most effective way to prevent pneumonia. Adequate nutrition is key to improve child natural defense mechanisms, starting with exclusively breastfeeding for the first months of six of life. And in addition to being effective in preventing pneumonia, it also helps to reduce the length of illness if a child does become ill. Addressing environmental factors such as indoor air pollution and encouraging good hygiene in crowded homes also reduce the number of children who fall ill with pneumonia. In children infected with HIV, the antibiotic clotrimazole is given daily to decrease the risk of contracting pneumonia. And there are several low cost effective antibiotic treatment for all children with pneumonia, and the price includes the antibiotic and diagnostics for pneumonia is managed. And coming to the WHO response and UNICEF Integrated Global Action for Pneumonia and Diarrhea aims to accelerate pneumonia control with a combination of interventions to protect, prevent and treat pneumonia in children with actions to the following. That is, you have to protect children from pneumonia, including promoting exclusive breastfeeding and adequate complementary feeding. And prevention includes pneumonia with vaccines, hand washing with soap, reducing household air pollution, HIV prevention. And coming to the treatment, pneumonia focusing on making sure that every sick child has access to the right kind of care, either from a community-based health worker or in a health facility if the disease is severe, and can get the antibiotics and oxygen they need to get well. A number of countries including Bangladesh, India, Kenya, Uganda and Zambia have developed district, state and national plans to intensify actions for the control of pneumonia and diarrhea. Many more have been integrated diarrhea and pneumonia specific action into their national child health and child survival strategies. For many countries, the most Millennium Development Goal agenda has exemplary included ending preventable diarrhea and pneumonia deaths as a priority action. Thank you.